Hello and welcome to OT Over Easy. My name is Becca and today, you best believe we're going to start talking about splints. So today, we're mostly going to be focusing on terminology kind of stuff, like what is a functional versus a protective splint, what is static, dynamic, static, progressive, blah, 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 those kinds of things. And in the future, I would like to make a video or maybe multiple videos about just specifically different kinds of splints that you might use for different diagnoses or different purposes. But I'm going to need your guys' help for that to let me know what you are coming across in your study materials. So you guys drop in the comments below what splints specifically you would like me to talk about, and I'll get on that. But for now, let's crack on. First, let's talk functional versus protective splint. Whether it's a functional or a protective splint is going to depend on what you're using the splint for. So just to clarify, a functional splint is a splint or orthosis that you are using to increase the patient's function versus a protective splint, which isn't necessarily functionally helpful for them, but it's helping protect an injury of some sort, be it a broken bone or a repaired tendon that was severed, something like that. It's protecting those structures while they're healing. So, for example, I've got on a little, what I would call a hand-based thumb spica. It's also sometimes called an opponent's splint. This can be a functional splint or a protective splint, depending on what you're using it for, and it looks exactly the same. So, as a functional splint, I might give this to a patient who has CMC arthritis, right? They have a lot of pain down here when they're using their thumb. This brace, because it essentially immobilizes that CMC joint and helps support this MCP joint, it allows a person who's wearing this splint to be able to function better throughout their daily routine because they can wear this and it helps them to take away that pain so they can use that hand more. In that case, it is a functional splint. It could also be used as a protective splint. Again, take a CMC arthritis patient. Maybe it's not someone who's seeing me for conservative management. Maybe they had joint replacement surgery and they need to protect that joint while those structures are healing. Boom, I might fabricate this very same splint because it's going to protect the joint structures. So really, functional versus protective, just think about what you're using the splint for. Don't get tripped up on that. So now let's talk static versus dynamic, etc., those kinds of terms. A static splint, quite simply, is static. It has no moving parts. This is a great example of that. It's just one solid piece of thermoplastic. Yes, it has a strap. Technically, the strap moves, but the functional part of the splint does not move, no moving parts. A serial static splint is a static splint that will go through a series of different forms. For example, I have treated some Dupuytren's release patients so they started here, they had surgery to release cording in their palm, popped their fingers up maybe here, but to help kind of get that final extension, we used static serial casting or splinting to help get that final extension. So their first splint kind of came under their finger like this to help stretch it out. And after a couple days and their finger was used to being there, we changed the splint so that it stretched it to there. And then we wait another couple days and then we stretch it to there and then to there. So it's the same splint, it's just changing its form slightly to help accommodate that increased range of motion. That is a static serial splint. A dynamic splint has some component that is movable that the patient does actively move while they were wearing the splint, whether it's an elastic strap like this, elastic bands, maybe outriggers with some springs attached. They can look kind of scary and complicated, but dynamic just means that the patient in some way can move that splint. It's not just one piece of solid hard plastic. A static progressive splint is a splint that is worn statically, but may have some dynamic component that the patient doesn't actively change while they're wearing the splint, but they may adjust it and then let the splint sit in a new static position. A really good example of this is a flexion glove. That's something that may be worn over your hand, and it's got elastic bands that attach to the fingers. If someone has trouble flexing their fingers and we're trying to increase that passive range of motion, we'll take those elastic bands and we'll strap them down to a piece of Velcro on the wrist to apply that stretch. And as that patient gets used to that stretch, then maybe they can take that rubber band and they can stretch it down a little bit more. So unlike the dynamic, where they're actively moving that dynamic piece while they're wearing the splint, while they're reaching for things and functioning in the splint, this one is just changing it and then it sits there. And it's not going back and forth. It's just the change and sit. That is a static progressive splint. Next, let's talk a little bit about basic fabrication principles. Number one is that it's important to kind of respect the shape of the hand and maintain its arches. So this is not a perfect one, but I molded it on myself using one hand. Okay, so give a girl a break. But you can kind of see I arched that palmer piece to respect that arch, that natural curve I have in my hand. What I didn't do is I didn't slap that flat and splint me here, because that's not going to be comfortable and it may even cause some deformities. So make sure you're respecting those arches of the hand. You also want to respect the creases of your hand. The creases of your hand are the places that cue you, that's where we're bending. That's where I need to be able to bend in order to use a certain joint. So for example, with my little hand spica, you can see that I have cleared the distal palmar crease there so I can bend at my MCPs. I've cleared my wrist creases so I can bend at my wrist. The other main crease that you usually want to be aware of is the thenar crease. This guy here. Now on this particular splint, because the idea is that I'm blocking my thumb, obviously that crease is not clear. But if you were making a splint, let's say for a broken finger on this side of the hand, maybe you want that thumb clear so you can use it. You're going to want to make sure it doesn't cross that thenar crease so that thumb has full ability to move. Next, make sure you're respecting the skin. So no sharp edges, no pointy bits that are digging in, nothing that's going to poke or rub, abrase the skin, create pressure points, anything like that. If you have dynamic components that are pulling on joints, you always want that angle of pull to be 90 degrees from the joint. So I'm not pulling this joint out that-a-way, I'm pulling it straight up 90 degrees. Generally speaking, if an exam question asks you what position a hand ought to be in a splint, with the exception of burns, which we may cover in a future video, the most likely thing they're looking for is something close to safe position. Generally speaking, the safest position for the hand is wrist in slight extension, about 20 or 30 degrees, MCPs in flexion about 60 degrees or so, IP joints pretty straight, and the thumb in palmar abduction. There are going to be some splints that deviate from this depending on what their purpose is, But honestly, a lot of that information you're not going to need to know as a general practitioner. That's more a hand therapist specialty kind of thing. So if you come across an exam question that asks, and you're not sure otherwise, I would tend to go for something that matches these kinds of measurements. And those are the basics of general splinting that you should know when studying for a generalist OT exam. If you think I missed anything, drop it in the comments below and I might clarify in a future video. But definitely, again, please put in the comments specific kinds of splints you're coming across that you would like me to talk about. And I will definitely do a video on those in the future. And in the meantime, I hope that this video makes understanding splinting a little more easy. Happy studying!